Good morning. You're listening to Central Wisconsin's 24-hour information station, AM 1320 WFHR. It's time now for the Morning Magazine, brought to you by Comfort Air Heating, Cooling, Plumbing. Now, with the Morning Magazine, here's Carl Hilke.
Thank you, Jerry, and good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's show on AM 1320 and streaming live at WFHR.com. We also welcome our friends from Wisconsin Rapids Community Media. Jesse is here. You can view our program on Solaris Channel 3 throughout the month, as well as Charter Channel 980. Five, and the reason Jesse is here is Wisconsin Rapids Mayor Zach Vruwink is here for the entire hour. We welcome the mayor of the city of Wisconsin Rapids, Zach Vruwink, and he's brought along a very special guest, too, this morning. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Carl, and good morning to our listeners.
Okay, well, it was a nice, quick meeting yesterday.
Yeah, it was. It was nearly a record, I think someone pointed out.
Yeah, well, hey,
Who's counting, though, right?
Yeah, that's right, but you can do that anytime you want. Okay, why don't you introduce, because you honored this gentleman at last night's meeting, and we have a tradition here of trying to bring him on the show to highlight their career. So go ahead.
Well, it's been kind of a series. This will be our second in 2 months where we've had an outgoing city leader, city official retiring from the city. Jim Nietzel is with me today, who's run most recently the wastewater plant, which we're all familiar with the importance of that. Jim, previous to that, had worked in public works, various public works activities and roles through his 38 years, Jim, right? Or nearly 38 years career that's been with the city.
It'll be 38.
It'll be 38 by that time. So Jim had his last city council meeting last night with us, and so we typically, it's our practice to recognize outgoing officials with a plaque, and so we did that last night, since he will not be, we don't believe anyway, will be at the next city council meeting in February.
Okay. Well, what's your feelings after such a long career?
Well, I can say I had a really good run. We got a lot of work done. I worked with a lot of people that were smart, and we had fun. You know, we had good-natured people, good-hearted people. So I can look back at my career and feel pretty satisfied as how it went, you know.
What's your proudest accomplishment?
Well, as a young guy, I ran the construction crew that built 25th Avenue from Gaynor Avenue all the way to West Grand. That was a two-year project. That was a big project, and we had good people working with us. That's a mile long. That was a big deal, and we actually came under budget. And then the treatment plant, that expansion was, quite an accomplishment for somebody who at times felt like his head was spinning on a stick, because we had construction crews and engineers there all the time, and it went on for 2 years, and, we spent a lot of money, and you had to make decisions, and I was the owner's representative, so in the end, I realized it was probably a bigger deal than I thought it was while I was doing it, but
that was after it was done, looked at what was built.
Like, wow, we did this,
So how in that area, in your area, how do you feel the city is going forward? Is it in good shape?
I think that we've implemented some new programs for inspecting utilities, which will greatly enhance the money spending. We're going to be able to spend money more wisely where it's needed the most by doing inspections, and I think that's, they're on the right track, and that, that was pushed by Joe Eichstead in engineering, and I had told him I agree 110%, this is what we got to do. So the people that I supervise now will be doing that work.
Okay, so yeah, in other words, for us taxpayers, that tells me, hey, we're going to get stuff fixed or find problems before they become major issues.
Right. Because when you're talking utility, you're talking big dollars.
Yeah. We got some old utilities in this city, too.
Oh, yeah. Just in the past year or so, I didn't realize it, but there's a number of sewers that are over 100 years old. And 100 years is, considered the lifetime of a underground utility. And They're over 100 years old, so they've been through their lifetime, and you know we're going to have to take care of them.
So that's going to be for your successor and future employees of your department. That's going to be their next big challenge, Your Honor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and rolling up, Jim kind of glazed over the details of that initiative where we're inspecting, and I think using new technology now, we're hoping to roll out the iPads to be able to do much more accurate data collection. So, you know, historically, as we know, when they built this stuff 100 years ago, we're lucky to have any descriptions about what was installed in the ground, and obviously more recently, over the decades, that changed. But, you know, trying to digitize our knowledge base so it's easy to run searches and queries to know how do you plan for something's replacement or ongoing maintenance. You know, we're looking at lining some things and those pieces there, and that's been a new approach for us.
How is the use of technology and the technology available for your job, is that the biggest change that you've seen during your career?
Oh, yeah. When the mayor first took office, you know, we had our initial meeting, and I told him, I said, you know, when I was in high school and we watched a videotape, it was reel to reel. There were no computers.
So, right.
You know, I've been a guy that's just had to learn as I go, where nowadays kids are, you know, they're not even in school yet, and they're looking at their iPads and, you know, really getting used to it. But, you know, you just go with the flow, and you got to do what you got to do, and you make it happen, and where, you count on the people underneath you.
Yeah. Where are the oldest utilities in the city located?
Well, not far from here, on the west side of the river, north and south of West Grand Avenue, out towards, probably between 8th Street and 8th Avenue and 25th Avenue, and then the same situation would be north of Baker between 8th and Highway 54 there.
If you're just joining us on the Morning Magazine, welcome. We're getting our monthly visit with Wisconsin Rapids Mayor Zach Vruwink, and we're saluting the career of Wastewater Superintendent Jim Nietzel, who was honored last night's meeting for his career, as he will be retiring. So, if you were going to recommend to your successor or the mayor of how we deal with these things, should we have it like from worst, the one that needs to be prioritized, these areas, or how should we go about fixing some of these areas before there is a problem?
Well, I think, as you know, as the mayor said, this is the information that we're going to be gathering electronically, you know, is going to be at the fingertips, literally at the fingertips of engineering. And, you know, we discuss, my people discuss what's going on with engineering, so we're going to have that priority list, and you're going to be able to spend the money where it means the most, and I think they're on the right track. You know, my new boss, Joe Terry, came, I don't know, how long has he been here?
Just over a year, year and a half or so.
Yeah, and Joe's got it dialed in, and he's got a great path forward.
How has environmental regulations, you've lived through the period where we, you know, you and I are old enough to remember when you did not think about fishing or in the Wisconsin River. You didn't even want to be near the Wisconsin River. Now it's become a recreational source. And it's because of a lot of different environmental regulations through the years. How has that changed your job during the years?
Well, my employees and I feel the same way. You know, what we do is we make water clean, and that makes the river fishable and swimmable and boatable. And, you know, I feel good about that. The Clean Water Act came along, and my dad had said to me one time, he said, I remember what it was like. He said, you couldn't swim, you couldn't fish.
Nope.
I grew up in the La Crosse area, and I remember on the radio they would have, they would give you the fecal count every day on the radio.
Oh, boy.
you know, they had the north side La Crosse Beach. You couldn't, they'd tell you day to day whether or not you could swim. Then the Clean Water Act came along, and that cleaned that all up. So, you know, I know there's listeners out there that don't like regulation, but some regulation is needed, and it's good.
Yeah, and especially when it's handled right and improves
the quality of life.
The quality of life, and it gives you an additional resource. And now we've got a recreational and tourist resource that people. So what are you going to do with your free time now?
Well, I just, I went over to Green Bay and I bought myself a planer. My son and I built a really nice shop a few years back. I'm going to be working in my shop, and I got a set of golf clubs, and I got a fishing boat.
Okay.
And
I'll probably see you out on the golf course somewhere then, I guess.
Well, I'll wave to you.
Okay.
I'll tell you what my score is.
No, that's okay. One duffer to another. That's what happens on the course stays on the course.
There you go.
But we wish you all the best, and congratulations on a great career. I guess, you know, did you ever think you'd be here that long?
Yeah, I mean, when I first got this job, I was just a young punk out of high school, and all of a sudden I've got a job that has paid holidays and health insurance. I'm like, wow, I just hit the jackpot. Of course, you know, that perception was twisted at the time, but no, the city's been good to me, and I knew that I would never get rich working for them, but I've gotten a lot of satisfaction out of my job, people I work with. You know, the people in the city are good people. I can remember many times going down a road when I'm the construction supervisor. You rip the entire road up. They don't have access to their driveways.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you make it very inconvenient for them. But you go and talk to them and say, this is what we're doing. This is how long it should take. This is when you can get in your driveway. And almost all people were very gracious and understood and were easy to get along with.
Yeah, but you might as well cooperate, and that way you guys can get your job done as quickly as possible. No use getting upset about it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, good luck. Enjoy your retirement, and thank you for your service to our city all these many years.
Well, thank you very much.
Okay. Well, Your Honor,
Yeah, I mean, Jim, it's been a pleasure to work with Jim, and he's obviously a fun guy. You can hear just the entertainment sort of value he gets in working with the people he works with every day, and I can say the same for him. You know, he also has overseen throughout the expansion of the plant, but the relationships we have with many of our industrial users, and whether they're Ocean Spray or Mariani, and, you know, we treat their waste in order for them to be in business in this community. And so I think, and obviously employ hundreds of people, and mm-hmm. so there's a real responsibility. Responsibility in that.
What was that like dealing with these businesses?
They're very smart people, and you have to really pay attention to what you're saying and what they're saying.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean that in a kind way.
Yeah.
It makes you step your game up, you know.
Mm-hmm. Because they got their business to run.
Oh, yeah.
And they have a need.
Yeah.
And they want a service from you, but they want it at a competitive price.
Yeah,
or they can go someplace else.
All you have to do is stop the access to a business tearing up the road, and you'll find out what's important.
Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, you've had a very interesting career. If nothing else, you've learned some diplomatic skills.
Well, I learned that you should build as many bridges as you can and don't burn them unless you absolutely have to.
Amen. That's a good philosophy of life.
Mm-hmm. Miss Jim's wisdom, if nothing else.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, good luck, sir. Good luck.
Thank you.
Since we're talking about public works and the like, why don't we begin by updating the recycling program? There was a clarification about fees last night. Joe Terry provided answers about, you know, if you want to change your carts, $55.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess right now he said the fee also applies to new construction.
Right, right. Yeah, so as a refresher, we launched recycling a week ago, Monday. Single stream recycling, so residents should be using by now their green recycling bins. They should have them removed from the curb on non-recycling day. I notice driving across town, there's a lot of properties. Many of them are rentals, you can tell, because they've got two parcels, two addresses, and there's two bins per house, which is a little bit strange for some. But, you know, pull those things away from the street when it's not recycling day. They should be single streaming, as you mentioned, by now. We do have one route yet that does not have their bins, and that was because of a miscount in the number of bins with the city needed. So those are on their way.
That's on the west side.
Yeah, I'm not sure. It's about 900 bins, and so I know they've had to manufacture and stamp and all that stuff. There's a whole process there, and then deliver them to the city. So we don't have an installation date or delivery date on those carts yet, but we expect it to be in a number of weeks. And if people have questions or concerns, contact the city garage. There's a number of technicalities with the bins and when, you know, where people place them at the curb. They have to be on a flat surface, so the automated arm can effectively pick them up. They should also make sure the lids are closed. I know some people have contacted me saying, well, I couldn't fit everything in. Well, the truck can't effectively dump it cleanly if it doesn't have the lid closed. So there's that component. And just making sure that people are actually using the bins and not putting garbage in them. I know that was a concern we saw across the city. Some people, the recycling word is on the front of the bin, and there's in every bin there was a instructions sheet that was placed.
Yeah, that's a good thing. Read that when you get your bin. If you read that instruction manual. I mean, it tells you what you have to do and what you can and can't put in there.
Yep. We understood there's going to be a major education curve to this because it's new and it's the first time we've ever had a practice such as this. So we have been putting little notices, yellow notices on the back of these recycle bins to let people know what they maybe didn't do correctly. We realize launching it in the winter and the snow that we've had has been a challenge, and finding places for it, whether it's alongside your garage or inside your garage or behind your house, has presented some challenges, but we certainly are being flexible with residents as they learn the program, and we hope that by spring that folks will have it figured out.
Like I said, I've seen these kind of bins in a lot of other municipalities, even around this area. And my brother and his wife, when they came up for the holidays from Palatine, Illinois, and they said they saw the new bin in our garage, and they go, oh, you guys finally got to the 21st century here. And they were kind of teasing us because they had seen the old, and they go, what's that? And now they go, we got you'll love it. And it worked fine for Pam and I at ours last week, first time.
I think if people truly single stream everything, I still separate my paper probably by habit here. But I take my paper directly to the recycler because it obviously gets used right in their processes. And I think that was a major reason why we didn't switch. It was because of the fact that we have a demand for our recycled paper right here. And so to have a dual stream collection system, it made sense to provide the sale of that paper to Corenzo here in Wisconsin Rapids, or for anybody else's paper making operations.
Yeah. And if you want to do that, you can still do that. Yeah. If you want to separate your cans, you can do that.
Yeah.
But if otherwise it's single stream, and the manual or the instructions on attached to the cart, very, very easy to understand.
Right.
And we'll get used to it. Mm-hmm. Okay. Want to talk about the facade program. And looking at my background material, I got my packet. It's done in cooperation with the Heart of Wisconsin Chamber of Commerce. Why don't you give us a little background and how this is going to be implemented? Because it looks like this could be something that could be very positive for the image of the city.
Absolutely, especially when you have such historic buildings that owners, for financial reasons or economic reasons, don't have the means to be able to preserve the architecture of the building. Mm-hmm. And the buildings we still have left in our downtown, the intention of this program, it's very common to see municipalities and cities have these programs because of the fact that they put a preference on historic preservation and bringing those buildings to life. Because if you drive around to downtowns in particular around the state, even small communities, there's a real pride in having historic buildings that are in good shape and that they look nice. And so it goes a long way with the city's image and how people perceive ourselves here. So this program here, we had a program very similar to it a good 4, 5, 6 years ago when we created it originally. There was a very narrow support that the program provided, and that was a maximum of $1,000 matching grant. It has to be matched for improvements to the facade of one's building in the downtown TIF district or the downtown boundaries. And we've gone a couple of years without the program. It was actually was utilized, and there were no funds left. And so over the last year and a half or 2 years, I've been discussing with our economic developer in-house as well as the chamber about what the demand might be as we've now prioritized investment again in the downtown. And it came to be that given the number of properties that have changed hands, that there are new owners in many of the properties downtown. In fact, over half of them have changed hands in the last number of years. So you have more willing owners that are a bit more ambitious about securing good long-term tenants that believe that the front of their building should look nice. And in some cases, you know, paint and some of those things really don't have a return on investment. So oftentimes that's why programs like this exist. And if any of our listeners have been downtown Stevens Point, let's say over the span of the last 10 years, you can really see a dramatic changeover in the fronts, the storefronts of those buildings. And many programs demonstrate that as soon as the facade is done, typically a new business follows because they see it as a reinvestment, more energy, more vibrancy. And so the intent here is to prioritize that. So the program does have a lot more expansive boundaries than the previous one. The maximum grant can be up to $20,000 for a single grant. So it'd have to be a $40,000 project or more for that to be the case. But we figured we would try it again. The funding source for this program is through our room tax monies that get accrued as a portion of for economic development purposes. So the city has really three different funding source or discretionary sources for its room tax collection. First of which goes to the Convention and Visitors Bureau. One goes for economic development, and then a small sliver goes to our parks and recreation, but primarily the park improvement program. So that's kind of the high level on the program.
What's the chamber's role in this?
So the chamber will be administering it. Essentially, they're going to be working with any potential applicants that might be interested in the program. We've done some marketing already, just kind of through social media and on my blog. I'm going to post on Monday this week to start letting the community know that this program may become possible, and it did get approved last night by the City Council. So the program has about $21,000 in it for potential support to do things like painting and lighting, windows, tile, signage, awnings, and canopies. Those are really the categories of which the program will support.
Well, you mentioned Stevens Point, you know, Portage, another rivers city, they're downtown. You know, they've spent a lot of effort to restore historic buildings, and you go to any number of being a golfer with some of my buddies when we've gone out of town to various golf courses. I always like to pay attention to the downtowns as we're driving through town, and you Reedsburg or Portage or whatever, you'll see that this is a trend. They want to preserve the look because it's a people find it charming, visitors find it charming, and it attracts people to the business district. So
it gets people out walking. I mean, that's kind of a walkability component, surprisingly, to the program, is because people, it's sort of a, those that are history buffs or like the architecture, they typically get out and spend time outdoors, which is something we want everyone to do more of course, as we.
So how are you going to publish, if a business owner is interested in this program? Should they contact the city or should they contact the chamber?
Contact the chamber, and Melissa Reichert, the president over at the chamber, would be a good person to start with. They can obviously contact the city for more information. We'll be posting the program. It's looking at my thing here. We've got at least 30 pages that explain the program. Now, fortunately, the application is, I think, 2 pages here. But 2 pages. So it does provide some guidelines that it's not, you know, just because you have this idea for the front of your building, it may not qualify. And so we want to make sure that we provide some design guidelines. So there's a number of recommendations in here. I joked with the Finance and Property Committee that there was in the downtown plan that was commissioned in 2007, it pointed to a need for a program like this. And it took pictures of some of the buildings, have been torn down by the city. Good Time Charlie's was one that was identified as needing some facade improvement. And then the cornice that was in the former Jim Spath building. But unfortunately, I don't think the designer or the architect guy here knew that the behind the cornice, let's say in Jim's Bath, was all black mold. In the case of Good Time Charlie's, had, you know, other issues. So, you know, I'm glad the program moved forward. I think we're going to have greater demand than we have money for. I'll say that. I think there's some buildings downtown. The Flatiron, if anyone's been by there, it needs a little bit of touch-up. The Retzloff building, which is the corner building where the former Schmitz Jewelry was located in, some great, beautiful cornices there that if you get close and you stop and look at it, they don't have any color to them other than some rust and things, but it'd be really cool to bring those back to life and kind of show off what they really look like.
Okay. Well, it has the potential to do a lot of good and for some folks to have some creativity. It will be interesting. I want to talk more about that and a bunch of other issues, and then we're going to open up the phone lines, too, at 715-424-2600. But it's time for our first break. You're listening to The Morning Magazine on AM 1320 and WFHR.com. We also welcome Jesse from Wisconsin Rapids Community Media. Back with more right after this.
Good morning, and welcome back to The Morning Magazine, presented by Comfort Air Heating, Cooling, Plumbing. It's time for part two. Once again, here's Carl Hilke.
Thank you, and welcome back, everybody, to today's show on AM 1320 and WFHR.com and on Wisconsin Rapids Community Media. So we're visiting with Wisconsin Rapids Mayor Zach Vruwink, and the phone lines are open at 715-424-2600. To put a wrap on the facade program, I guess this is an example of what we call, it's the trend, because both the private sector and the public sector both don't have enough money to do everything they would like to see done. Mm-hmm. And so when you join forces, you can get a lot more done more economically, correct?
That's right.
So this is a good example of a public, quote-unquote, public-private partnership.
And because there's been so many demonstrated programs that have been successful, statewide or regionally or nationally even, that many of them show that for every dollar, there is a multiplier effect of every public dollar that goes in that creates private investment. And that's the type of government investment that is awesome to see, right? Because it's not a one-to-one. I mean, many government services, the dollar just evaporates and there's nothing to show for it. But in this type of program, obviously for generations to come, if it's facade improvement in this case, as we're talking, the funding source being room tax dollars, if we're collecting somebody else's money when they're staying in our community, and we're investing it right back in the image of the community, and obviously business enterprise and job creation and all that good stuff.
Okay, what about the good time former labor temple, as I like to call it, building? It's down now. What's the next step?
There's some foundations near there that are still in the ground, and so any excavation that'll happen as a result of a development partner that we may find out there in the future here will be responsible or find a way to remove the rest of that. But yeah, the building by and large is down. The environmental consultant that was awarded the contract, which has done a lot of the other environmental in that block, will begin their work now that the other demolition and salvager is out of the picture. And so they're going to identify to the extent that there might be environmental contamination under the building's footprint, or the former building's footprint now. I know that they had smelled gas when they were there, petroleum fuels products, because of the old gas station that was next door when they were doing some demolition work. And so we already knew that was there. So we hope to kind of get a better idea of how large is it, what's the soil contamination look like, and then from there we'll get a report back to tell us is it how great the extent is, and then the city council and administration and staff and I will discuss, are we going to do this, or is this going to be put on a development partner if they wish to put such as underground parking, for example, those things, or build and put a foundation under the ground? They may have to do some environmental remediation.
Okay.
So our goal is to eliminate the unknowns. The more knowns there are about a development site, the more likely and more successful a development will happen there. And so that's really the whole impetus for why the city is involved in any of this on the Triangle project. Is number one, there was a lot of environmental that there was there. There were a lot of blighted, vacant, and some contaminated buildings. And so we wanted to ready that site for reuse. And that's kind of along the governor's mission of ready for reuse and shovel-ready sites. It's our intention to get this site shovel-ready. Actually, the next meeting I'm going to have after our show here today is to continue to strategize on where we take the development with city staff. And so we're going to be discussing a recommendation that'll go to the city council at some point in the future here to accept requests for proposals. And so we'll request proposals from potential development partners, and that can be local developers, it can be developers from outside the community, to tell us kind of what their proposal would be to develop the site.
Have you already received some input from developers who have said, yeah, I see what you're doing here, Mayor, you and the council have approved this, keep us posted because we're interested? Have you received any kind of
the whole gamut from no, we're not interested in Wisconsin Rapids, but thanks. We'd be interested. And one developer in particular that expressed with a request for qualifications, the phase right before this, they submitted a formal request for qualifications. We're going to continue to beat the bushes because we'd like multiple interested formal interested parties, to see what they can share with us as their expertise. I think it's healthy to have a good competitive process. The challenge is, this is the first project of its kind in our market. And a lot of times developers don't like to be first. They want to be second or further, because they know that there's a risk factor that's different.
But there's been other developments up and down the river. How is this different from those?
Well, it's something I shared this morning. I think somewhat of a confidence and a knowledge barrier that people have about our community that we have to continue to educate.
Okay.
It's one of the main reasons we did the housing study, was to demonstrate that there is a housing need in this community. And it's not just in single family or in apartments or in townhouses or in senior housing. It's across the spectrum. And we need to continue to make sure that we're doing something about that, or our economy will continue to be drugged down because employers cannot find employees because there isn't the type of housing that people want to live in the community in.
To me, it sounds like maybe we got a little bit of, because of, you know, we took some hits. Mm-hmm. This area took some hits. Because of that, we took some hits. There's this like it's like a battle, like you're playing on a team that's been always losing, and you got a new coach comes in and says, "Okay, we're gonna turn this thing around." You're going, "No, you're not." Mm-hmm. We lack self confidence. We gotta get our self confidence back.
Yeah. There's some of that, especially in the local developer scene. That it's we've all heard it. I wouldn't do that in Wisconsin Rapids for X, Y, and Z reason, or it may not even be a reason. It's simply they just feel, for whatever reason, perception wise, I just wouldn't do that.
Well, somebody said that about the NEPCO project. Look what happened there.
Yeah, right. And I even just ran into somebody the other day from Madison. He goes, "Yeah, NEPCO. How far is that from Wisconsin Rapids?" I said, "Well, were you there? Because you would have run into the city limits practically." And he was looking at buying a vacation home. I mean, building a vacation home. It's much more real than I think those of us that live here every day and go to work here every day than we think sometimes.
Well, here's another factor that's going to play into this. In fact, tomorrow in our monthly Town of Rome report here, we're going to have the airport manager.
Oh, good.
Okay, because the Sand Valley... Well, those folks fly in to play a high-end golf course. Mm-hmm. A lot of them are entrepreneurs.
That's right.
They're business owners. They don't just fly to go play golf. They are always constantly looking for opportunities. Yeah. And Rick Bakokas shared this with me. They're looking around going, "Have you guys ever thought about doing this? No one's ever thought about doing this." Mm-hmm. If someone local doesn't wake up and jump into the game... Don't cry if someone from out of the town or some out of the region somewhere comes here and says, "Sign me up, because I know I can make this
That's
work."
Right. One, in those folks that are flying in on a private private aircraft are spending a good $10,000 per hour to land here and to leave here sometime. So there is disposable income to be had. And if we have a confidence factor issue here, we got to set that aside pretty quickly, because we're just not going to be positioning ourselves for development.
No, or you're going to see someone from outside will do. Mm-hmm. And then I can hear, if someone from outside did this, why couldn't we have had someone local? Well, you had the opportunity.
Yeah. And that's why it's important, like our projects. And I was going to, if Jim wasn't here with me this morning, at our next visit, bring our economic developer from the city, Adam Tagan, to join me to talk about all of the many in-house sort of things we are continuing to do to make sure we're ready for development. And one of which we've talked about a little bit on your show, and I'll speak about it from a public perspective. Adam will typically speak about it from a technical perspective, and that's the zoning code that many people wonder why the certain development standards exist in our community. Why did they build that like that? Well, it's because a lot of times our zoning code has been so outdated, we haven't accounted for new development practices. So in a future visit, I'll have Adam join me. But that's really important to get that critical foundational zoning parameters established, so you get the right type of developments and the right type of places in the community. Otherwise, it really creates this haphazard, gosh, who was in charge here kind of an attitude about the city.
And Representative Krug and I talked about this in relation to what happened, been going on in, to the south with the proposed CAFO. Mm-hmm. Because of the lack of zoning there, that led to the problem. And Representative Krug says, then we have to come in as the state. We're expected to clean up a mess, which should have been regulated locally with local zoning.
There's a whole question of zoning, right? And fortunately, cities have to adopt it. Towns, there's an option.
Yeah. Okay, let's talk about, before we go to break, another property. It was a sale of city property, 2330 16th Street South to North Point Development. What's involved there? What's the status as a result of the council action last night?
So this was the same development proposal that was just south of here on 25th and Alton.
Okay.
And given the neighborhood opposition, the I don't want that in my neighborhood or built there, the developer withdrew their application. And we worked with them to identify other sites. We had this site on their list originally. It wasn't their ideal choice because it's not entirely owned by the city. There's a lot of private property. So this is at 16th and Pepper. And so the developer will be building townhouses there if they're successful in their application of federal tax credits. So they're going to be applying for those here this spring. And we should know hopefully by March whether or not they're successful. So last night's council decision was to sell the property. It's a small piece to the entire development, but this would be adjacent to the YMCA, the former Advanced Fiberglass Technologies property, previously sold to another developer for the exact same reason, a different tax credit program. That was low-income housing tax credits. This one's Section 42 workforce housing, so there's some employment requirements and such, income requirements. There's drug tests, all of those.
When we're talking about workforce housing, what are we talking about? Transient workers?
Good question. It's a state and federal program that's administered here in the state, and essentially developers get tax credits for selling or by putting a market putting units in that are subsidized at the market rate or at a rate that gives folks with certain income levels the ability to afford them. So these would be folks, I would say, that number one, they're employed, so they might be working at Walmart, they might be working at Ocean Spray, but there's a limit, there's a maximum amount of income that they can earn in order to take residence there. Now, there will be some market rate housing as well. It might be 10% of the development. So it'll be folks that have any income level will be able to live there as well. But this is intended to provide a incentive, an ability for folks to find good, affordable, quality housing. I mean, it's not just affordability, right? It's also quality housing.
Okay. So these are working folks.
These are working folks, right?
Right.
If people are making anywhere from probably minimum wage, if they're making, $14,000 a year, up to probably 17 or so bucks an hour, $35,000, $36,000, they're going to qualify to live.
But if they're working, putting in their 40 whatever hours, and they're entitled to find some decent housing too.
Yeah, and they're going to be beautiful units, so 2-3 bedroom townhouses. We don't have many townhouse developments in the community, especially very few new ones. And those that are in the rental market know that the data shows that we're nearly full. And now there's obviously new developments that are continuing to recruit, but that takes time. I mean, many of these folks that are working in the community that found housing outside the community, they're not going to just pick up and move because a housing unit opens up. So I think this is for the health of our economy, and I think it's a good use of city property, and we're going to make some money on the back end on the sale of the property to them.
And it's improvement of a lot into something attractive, where folks who are working will have a nice place to live and work in our city.
And about $1.5 million in tax base on the city parcel alone.
Wow.
So there will be some nice new tax growth there. And it's about a $5, $6 million development. It's not a small development.
And if all the pieces come together, when does North Point anticipate starting construction?
It'll be yet this fall, if in fact they get the tax credits this spring.
Okay. Now, what happens if they don't? If that falls through, then this whole deal falls through?
It's contingent upon them getting the tax credit, so they could choose to come back to us and say, hey, we want another go-around at it. They've been batting 100, though, on the state tax credit application. They did one in De Pere. If folks are familiar with where Walmart is off of 41, they're working on one in Sparta. And they've got another one, I think, in the Oshkosh market. So they've been successful in these areas. And the states, from what I can tell, they really view these guys as quality above board developers.
Okay, so that's the kind of developers we want to attract
absolutely.
To our community.
Mm-hmm.
That's another thing. When you have a quality developer coming to your community, you don't want to tick them off so badly that they leave and then tell, hey, don't go to Rapids.
Right, exactly. Yeah, and that word travels fast because these, you know, we all know our networks are small.
Right.
Or connected anyway, tight. And I think these guys would be no different there.
Okay. We've got to take our final break and then be back with more here on The Morning Magazine. In Wisconsin Rapids. Welcome back to the final segment of the Morning Magazine with Wisconsin Rapids Mayor Zach Vruwink. Jesse's here also from Wisconsin Rapids Community Media. And we've had a very interesting discussion about a number of things. But here's something that's coming up. We just heard the state of the state from the governor. Everybody's waiting for the budget. And so my question for you is, what are you hoping to hear from the budget, from the governor's budget message?
Well, that, you know, obviously the party in charge has been emboldened, right? New members, right. Were, you know, our new state senator, Pat Teston.
Which you met again.
Yeah, talking about budget priorities. My hope is that, you know, and Pat is on the chair of the workforce committee, right? Mm-hmm. You know, very powerful, very important committee. And my hope is that, you know, we get serious about dealing with the shortage of workers we have in this state. It's affecting our community. It's affecting our ability to get the people that our businesses need employed. And so that impacts our ability to create jobs here in our city. And I think that's, I sure hope you heard, the governor's talked about it. It's just a matter of how are they going to make it happen. And that's one thing, I hope infrastructure continues to be a important piece. We've got a proposal that's been circulated for airport improvements and trying to get state aid for some of the important improvements to make Sand Valley, our responsiveness to Sand Valley, that much more successful. And that's something that's going to impact the entire state. So to ask all the state's taxpayers to pay for it is completely appropriate. I mean, locally, we can't afford to do it all ourselves here.
Okay. We got our first call of the morning, and good morning. You're on The Morning Magazine with Mayor Vruwink.
Good morning. Thanks for taking the call. A little different change of pace on the recycling bins. It's been quite a conversation. I know it was even discussed at last night's meeting. I think a lot of citizens didn't realize what the bins were going to be like. In fact, I even spent a morning over at the city garage, and everybody there that came in or was calling in, I could hear them were all complaining about their garbage bins and wanted a different size. And I think it's just one of these things where people didn't realize it till when they got them. And I was wondering if now that people have them, if there couldn't be a day where you could exchange them, or maybe you could even partner with somebody like Encourage, and they could do like a community event regarding it. Thanks for taking my call. I'll take the answer off the air. Thanks.
Okay, thank you for your call.
Yeah, thanks for the call and the question. I'll tell you, I have floated the idea of maybe sort of an amnesty day, or is there a threshold here? You know, we had utilized ODC for a mailing service. Everybody got a letter. However, it went to the property owners and not necessarily the tenants or vice versa. And so we had some challenges and gaps in communication. We felt like we addressed them in a second round of communication. We did allow residents a month of a window in the first communication to choose the size of their bin at no charge. However, as the caller pointed out, there's been some complexities with that. And I've advocated for a relooking at how we address this. Now, the challenge has been folks have paid the $55 to change the size. So, you know, there's obviously,
yeah,
the easy way is just refund them their money. But I think, you know, we do need to relook at this a little bit and to determine if we're going to need to change. You know, the size consideration is very real for those of us that have a one-stall garage and don't have a lot of space inside. I prefer to store them inside so you don't see them from the curb. So a smaller bin might make more sense. I know we had many months of conversation about this, and I think it just kind of, folks heard about it and didn't realize, oh, this is real, this is happening. And we had these bins at the lobby at City Hall for almost a year.
I know. I went and checked it out.
Yeah.
Pam and I checked it out just to see which one. And we took the large one, and we got a one-stall garage, and it fits in ours.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think the single streaming, folks realize that a lot more things are recyclable than they previously thought.
Yeah,
by looking at, you know, food trays and all these pieces, there's a lot of plastics, a lot more plastics than people think are recyclable. But in terms of the caller's point, you know, we did order another round of bins, which were at the large size. So we intend to carry an inventory of them. But, you know, I'll explore the idea, you know, of the community recycling. There's a lot of places in the community I know that we miscounted. We didn't even think about our park system. If we're going to expect our residents to recycle, I said at the Parks Commission last month, I'm going to expect our residents to recycle at our large events at our parks, too. There's no reason why we have these different standards. So, you know, I appreciate the caller's comment and suggestion. And and would be happy to hear more of the caller's ideas on it, now knowing that I'm open to it.
Okay. Well, let's get to our next caller. Good morning. You're on the Morning Magazine.
Good morning. I was listening to what you were just talking about. Couple things. One is kind of an ongoing problem with code enforcement. You see so much of it, you just wonder why things have been reported, nothing ever seems to get done about it. And I guess the other thing, which is completely different, what's the city's views on this Waisaki farm going in? I mean, those golf developments and stuff are going to affect people are going to stay here, you know, I'm sure. You know, what is the city doing, anything looking into that, trying to stop that farm or make it smaller or whatever needs to do? And I guess that's it.
Sure.
Get off, hang up, and listen to your response. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, the code enforcement piece is a real concern. We've got one code enforcement officer. I think we could probably have three and still not get to all of the issues. But the caller did raise a very valid point, and concern is, you know, I report personally. I use our smartphone app. I'm reporting violations when I see them because I believe it creates a better, stronger community. It improves the you know, visibility and sort of our image. But as our code enforcement officer will tell you, he has to go through the municipal court process, and so he has to have a solid case. There's also due process. We just can't slap some handcuffs on somebody and send them to jail because they've got cars parked on the front of their lawn, in front of their house. You know, well, some of us maybe would like that because they've been staring at these things for so long. There is a lot of due process. And I know with grass complaints, that's one of our big ones in the summertime, mowing, where we actually go and mow yards and issue a citation back. And talking about how do we shorten up some of that due process so that way we're getting a lot more remedy and fix very quickly. So that's obviously the first chunk I can go on. I know we're almost out of time on the thing. We've got another caller.
Yeah. What about about the CAFO?
Yeah. We've been watching the CAFO development. We've been, you know, it's not in our jurisdiction, so it's no different than me not wanting something else in Pittsville to be developed because it might, you know, smell here. We've all got to eat. There's been a migration from family farms to these large farms. You know, of course, I'm concerned about the impact, environmental impact. You know, I'm a believer in stewardship of resources. We only get one planet. And, you know, if we screw it up for the next generation, they're not going to have it. So there's a whole host of complexities. And I wish I could get more on that. And I know the caller's not going to be pleased, but that's sort of the city's view on it and has been. And we just continue to watch the development.
Quickly, you're the last caller. Real quick.
I was wondering what happened that the Tuesday route did not get their bins, and that it's going to take 6 to 8 weeks to get them.
We kind of talked about that at the start of the show, but maybe the mayor can
Great question. The director of public works, when you counted the single family, and then there's been so many conversions in rentals in this town from single family to multifamily units where there's actually two split units in a single family home. That's actually, they get two bins, and there was at least 600 of those across the city that originally when they were looking at the parcel count, we counted the number of parcels. Well, there can be two residences on one parcel. And so that really, for between single family, or I'm sorry, between two family, three and four family, we ended up being 900 short.
Okay.
And the director of public works has been really forward about it. But I appreciate the clarification.
Thank you very much.
Thank
okay.
You.
Yeah. Basically, what happened? You had single family housing that became a duplex.
Yeah, exactly. And my neighborhood has them. You know, I struggle with the fact that they need two bins because they're sitting at the curb yet, and I got to drive by them and look at them all the time. Well, I've reported them to the ordinance control officer, so hopefully Ray's working on that.
I'm going to report something to you right now.
Sure.
Hey, why is the light at 2 Mile and 8th Street flashing?
2 Mile and 8th Street?
Yeah.
I'm not sure. I don't know the answer to that. Maybe Water and Light is doing maintenance on it. I know our traffic controllers are really old in this town, and we're starting to replace them.
That's a busy intersection, it's flash, at least the red, on 2 Mile.
We've started to replace the controllers. It's very expensive, but we've started to replace them on a replacement cycle.
Okay. Well, as always, I appreciate the time. A very interesting program, and we'll do it again next month.
All right, Carl. Thanks, and thanks to our listeners.
And we thank all of our listeners and Wisconsin Rapids Community Media for being here as well, and that's going to do it for the Morning Magazine.